This analysis of Jak and Daxter will take an in-depth look at the design of the entire game. It's the first video in a series on the Jak games, but it's also the fourth in a series on Naughty Dog. If an analysis of the Crash Bandicoot series sounds like something you'd be interested in, that's also a good place to start. Jak and Daxter, the Precursor Legacy, was released in late 2001, around a year after the launch of the PlayStation 2. The game is a collectathon, a subgenre of 3D platformer which had its heyday on the N64 with games like Banjo-Kazooie and Super Mario 64. By definition, a collectathon requires the player to collect a number of key items while navigating levels. In Jak and Daxter, these are called power cells. Progress to new levels is gated behind a required number of collectibles set by the developers. At a glance, it's easy to call Jak and Daxter derivative. Nintendo and Rareware had been refining the genre over the course of the N64's entire lifespan, and Insomniac had been making the Spyro games literally 5 feet away from Naughty Dog's cubicles. It's important to remember, however, that this was something completely new for Naughty Dog. In the previous generation, their 3D platformers had instead been extremely linear experiences which only gated progress behind the completion of levels. Of course, the developers and experience didn't shield them from genre fatigue, so Naughty Dog had to step up and do something unique to reinvigorate the genre. This wouldn't be the last time these developers would take a game design that was already popular and try to improve on it. And with the power of the PlayStation 2, they did. Jak and Daxter was the first ever platformer with a completely seamless, interconnected 3D world. Provided the player has collected enough power cells, they can travel from the very beginning of the game to the very last level with no load screens in between. Some level transitions could be called well-disguised loading screens, with the camera carefully angled to hide pop-in, but all of these remain in-engine and the game never once cuts to black. Of course, record-breaking technology can't make a game good by itself, but a lot of games still can't pull this trick off today, so it deserves to be recognised. The story begins with Jak and Daxter heading to a forbidden island. There's some narration by Samos the Sage, which establishes his character well before he even makes an appearance.
And why would he want to listen to old Samos the Sage anyway? I'm only the master of green ego, one of the wisest men on the planet.
Daxter falls into some dark eco, which turns him into perfect platformer sidekick material and sets the duo off on an adventure to change him back. Considering that I just summed it up in a couple of sentences, you could argue that this cutscene goes on too long, but to be fair, there are more concepts to introduce here than there ever were in Crash. A handful of characters need their personalities established, and the concepts of eco, the sages, and the precursors need to be introduced. These concepts feed into gameplay, so it's best that they're demonstrated early on. What I can't forgive about this cutscene is that it's unskippable. Personally, I've reconsidered replaying the game in the past simply because I was looking to play something immediately and I knew I'd have to sit through all this again. Jak and Daxter jump into a teleporter which transports them to the tutorial stage. This is the only time the game breaks its interconnected world rule. The tutorial stage is divorced from the rest of the game to prevent players from wandering into more difficult areas before they've been taught how to play. The tutorial can appear inconsistent because it stops the game entirely to point out what some of the collectibles are, but never says a word about combat, despite the training dummies littered everywhere. The fact is, all the tutorial dialogue is in reference to the game's unique concepts: green and blue eco, precursor orbs, power cells, scout flies. The only time the player is told how to control the game is in some dialogue about double jumps. This tutorial assumes you've played games before and know how to control one, but not that you've played collectathons before. This is very much a tutorial for people who spent the entire PS1 generation playing Crash Bandicoot. Once the tutorial is completed, Daxter and Samos exchange a few quips before the game sets the player loose on the world. Daxter's proven to be a very divisive character in the 15 years since the game launched. People seem to either love him or hate him, with little in between. His dialogue is mostly juvenile humour aimed at children in the first game.
Wow! put it on ice, big guy!
But as we'll see in the sequels, he becomes far more entertaining from an adult perspective, and for that I can't help but love him. As far as I'm concerned, Naughty Dog and Daxter's voice actor Max Casella rightly deserve all the praise they've received for the character. Thanks to a combination of excellent acting, writing, and voice direction, Casella always sounds like he understands the context of Daxter's dialogue. None of Daxter's lines ever have emphasis in the wrong place. From here, the player can go to either Sentinel Beach or the Forbidden Forest as their first level. The beach is the easier choice, with wide open areas and no need for precise platforming, and some dialogue casually guides the player towards going there first. The beach has by far the simplest objectives to collect power cells, chasing some seagulls and punching some defenseless rocks. There's even one power cell just sitting there. The player needs absolutely no skill whatsoever to get this one except knowing how to move Jak towards it. Coming here first, the player might notice a blue eco vent they can't open yet. This teaches that some levels can be revisited after vents are opened later, but there are enough power cells in the game that backtracking is never strictly necessary. Heading into the Forbidden Woods, it's clear that this level is the more difficult of the two. The enemies don't pose much more of a challenge, but the jumps are tighter and there are more gaps to fall to the bottom of the stage. There aren't any bottomless pits here, so there's a safety net for players still getting used to the controls, but climbing back up is its own sort of punishment. I've always liked the sound effect when walking on Precursor metal. It sounds to me like the ground is reacting to Jak's presence instead of just supporting his weight. It fits nicely with the framing device that Jak is destined to discover who the Precursors were. The first of very few bosses is in this area. It follows that unfortunate boss formula of exposing itself for no reason after each cycle of attacks. This fight is really just a matter of waiting for a blatantly obvious opening, and it's the same kind of simplistic boss design seen in the Crash games. It's about the right level of difficulty for this early stage in the game, but if, say, one of the vines had gone limp and the player had to punch it to open up the leaves, the fight would have felt just a little less condescending. Collectathons, and platformers in general, have commonly sold themselves on gameplay variety, always keeping the player doing something new. Whether it's using the base gameplay mechanics in novel ways, introducing new sets of mechanics that only appear a handful of times, or having the player participate in one-off minigames. We've seen this all throughout the Crash series, and for its part, Jak and Daxter has beam reflecting, hoverbike riding, first-person shooting, and more. Variety isn't necessarily a strength, of course. I was harsh on Crash 3 for overdoing it, and was perhaps too lenient on Crash 1 because of it. But if every gameplay variant is at least up to par, and the focus is still clearly on the central mechanics, variety can create something greater than the sum of its parts. This brings me to the fishing minigame. This minigame is not good. The controls don't allow enough precision. The lack of acceleration on the net means that it hits maximum velocity the moment it's adjusted at all. This leads to the player overshooting their targets and creates a feeling like you're wrestling with the controls. Here's the thing though. This minigame awards one power cell. The game requires 72 power cells to beat. There are 101 power cells in the game. The player doesn't have to complete this minigame. What this means is that if I criticize a one-off mechanic or minigame, the counter-argument can always be that you don't have to do it. The player only needs to find about three-quarters of the game satisfactory. If they find a particular power cell too hard or too frustrating, they aren't required to persist and potentially damage their opinion of the game. Thing is, this isn't really a problem except when trying to analyze the entire game in depth. For the average player, Naughty Dog could throw in every challenge they came up with, safe in the knowledge that players don't have to do the ones they don't like. I'm tempted to call this an easy out, but I have to acknowledge that most players are only ever going to be positively impacted by this design philosophy. To go back to the fishing, it actually is unique, as it's the only minigame that must be specifically completed to access an entire level, Misty Island. However, this still follows the same philosophy. There are enough power cells in the game that the player can skip a level entirely if they wish. By the time I unlocked Misty Island, I already had enough power cells to move on. I think it would be a shame for any player to miss an entire level, especially if it's because they can't beat this one minigame, but the fact remains that beating the minigame is indeed never required. Collectathons are rather unique because progression is tied to the same collectibles as 100% completion. Every single power cell is potentially part of the main game, but very few of them are necessarily part of the main game. What this means for me is that I have to consider every objective in the game while writing this analysis, because every power cell is potentially part of an average playthrough. However, I also have to acknowledge that some of my critique will not apply to everyone, because not every power cell is necessary. Rounding off all that introspection is that most intellectual of minigames, cattle herding. By 2001, it seemed like every collectathon had to have one of these, but I've always thought that they slow the pace to an absolute crawl. At a stretch, you could say these use an entirely unique set of movement mechanics, since they ask the player to influence the AI's direction instead of directly controlling it. The next level, Misty Island, maintains about the same level of difficulty as the Forbidden Woods, so it's a good time to talk about Jak's core moveset. Jumps and double jumps should be self-explanatory if you've ever played a platformer before, and if you haven't, well, what are you doing here? The dive attack is similar to the body slam from Crash. It has a much shorter recovery time, but it's just as situational, and only a good offensive option against a few specific enemies. This goes double for the uppercut, which is taught to the player in the first level and is only useful on one enemy type ever again. I'm saving roll jumps for a later level, which just leaves combat. Combat is never intended to be difficult in Jak and Daxter, with the vast majority of enemies taking only a single hit to defeat. In fact, it comes across as a very fringe element of the game's design. Enemies can't be placed to block the player's forward momentum, since they're so easy to defeat. As a result, combat can't be combined with platforming challenges in engaging ways. It actually borders on neglect, because the game comes agonizingly close to doing this successfully. The driller enemies, which show up late in the game, must be baited to attack by the player, but aren't vulnerable themselves until they've finished their attack animation. The one level where these driller enemies appear also includes collapsing floors. These two elements seem purpose-built for one another, but they never intersect. It's extremely easy to imagine a scenario where the player has to bait the enemy and then wait for it to be vulnerable while also managing where they're standing so that the floor doesn't collapse under them. The game never takes the two concepts far enough to try this combination though, and it's a massive missed opportunity considering that all the elements are already here. Instead, enemies are very simply placed to make sure the player still has something to do when they aren't platforming. When the game does throw large amounts of enemies at you, it's always in arenas which involve no platforming whatsoever. These always boil down to mashing one of the two attack buttons. Jak has two main offensive attacks, a lunging punch directly ahead of him, or spin kicking like Crash and damaging everything around him. The forward punch can prove useful at times to close the gap between Jak and an enemy quickly, but the spin kick soon becomes the superior option due to the strange recovery time on the punch. It's only fair that there's a downtime after a punch where Jak can't punch again for a brief moment, but this delay feels longer than it should be. It feels like Jak should be able to punch again at this point in his animation, because that's when the player can cancel the punch animation into a different move. A spin or a jump or just moving around. Instead, Jak can only punch again at this point in his animation, when the punch is complete and he begins to pull his fist back towards his body. In other words, the only move that can't cancel the end of the punch animation is another punch. This leaves Jak vulnerable for longer than the player feels like he should be. It's the only conspicuous issue with Jak's controls and makes the spin kick the vastly superior option, since it has a shorter delay and a wider area of effect to boot. On the other hand, Misty Island is also a good time to pinpoint why Jak and Daxter's level design excels among 3D platformers. I think it's because any given route from one side of an area to the other contains all the elements of a self-contained level. This is best demonstrated through gameplay, so what you're seeing now is me taking a few different paths through Misty Island from the same starting point. There are always obstacles and enemies placed at regular intervals, keeping the player jumping and punching, always doing something beyond simply running to their goal. You could condense these possible routes into linear paths, and all the elements needed to make the platforming engaging would still be present and correct. There's another cartoony collectathon that I think makes for a good point of comparison. Anyone who's played the first Tie the Tasmanian Tiger game will know that sprawling open levels aren't necessarily engaging on their own. The game tends to clump platforming challenges in one place, and then asks the player to simply walk towards them over large spaces of flat ground. I think that this is what elevates Jak and Daxter's level design. No matter where they're going, the player is always traversing a level and overcoming obstacles. Exploring a level in Tie, a player spends a lot of time simply running across it. The next set of levels is accessed via a race through a canyon on Jak's anti-grav zoomer. It's a fairly simple stop-and-go driving mechanic, but there's enough for the player to consider here that it stays interesting for the short time it lasts. Avoiding lava, popping coolant balloons, and keeping an eye on the temperature gauge gives the player plenty to think about. It was a common trope in collectathons to have one level use a set of mechanics other than the basic moveset. Jak and Daxter is no exception, and the Precursor Basin is played entirely on the zoomer. Levels like these run the risk of being variety for variety's sake. In this case, though, the fact that the zoomer can jump puts it a little more in line with the ideals of a platformer. You'll still be jumping around a lot, you'll just be doing it at a higher speed. The slow turning speed and massive turning radius make this weed-killing minigame pretty poorly thought out. But for the most part, the chase and race objectives given here are good fits for the zoomer's movement. The difficulty of the platforming is significantly ramped up in the Precursor City, with fewer safe places to stand and some electrified water. It's worth noting, though, that there still aren't any instant death pits here. If the player falls into the water, they're likely to take damage but can still climb out. While we're here, I should probably say something about the game's secondary collectibles. Scout flies will be a familiar concept if you've played a few collectathons. Collect 7 of these and you get a power cell. The way I see it, they're a good way to get players exploring every inch of a level. They can be put in places which are somewhat difficult to reach, but not difficult enough that the player deserves a whole power cell. You could think of these as 1/7 of a power cell. The same goes for precursor orbs. By trading 90 orbs for one power cell, you could see it as exploring 90 really obvious locations instead of one challenging one. The boggy swamp gives me an opportunity to mention the roll jump move. Rolling into a jump gives the jump more distance. It's very similar to the slide jump introduced in Crash 2. Players with the skill to pull it off can reach some power cells which an unskilled player would have to skip over, but it's never actually required to finish the game. When the gang arrives at the Red Sage's lab, the game's villains are finally established. They appeared in the opening cutscene, but it's only now that they become a clear threat. It's an uncommon quirk of Jak and Daxter's story that there's no villain for the majority of the game. The events of the game are simply a reaction to Daxter's transformation. This is uncommon in games, let alone platformers, because a clear villain creates conflict, which is both a good motivator and a good justification for combat. By cartoony platformer standards, I think it's impressive that Jak and Daxter manages to have persuasive motivation without a villain. It would have been even more remarkable if the entire game had sustained this. Jak and Daxter could have arrived at the Dark Sage's Citadel and only then discovered that he'd gone mad. To be fair though, some kind of build-up for the final boss is to be expected, and this isn't a flaw, just a matter of taste. The next level is Spider Cave, which came up earlier when I talked about the driller enemies. Here, there's one last aspect of the controls to take a look at. You've probably noticed by now that I've been spinning at the end of a lot of my jumps. Doing a spin kick in mid-air gives the jump extra height and slows Jak's falling speed. Spinning at the top of a double jump sends Jak about as high as a crouch jump. But it's the added distance that has the greatest effect on gameplay. The extra height combined with the slowed fall means that spinning after a double jump gives it a little more length. A lot of the jumps in the later game are spaced with this in mind. They aren't so long that a roll jump is needed, but they are too long for a double jump, so a spin is necessary. This is something that Crash 3 considered but never fully committed to. In that game, the player was given a similar spin glide move, but never needed to use it to complete the main game. Unlike Crash 3, Jak and Daxter actually does design some of its jumps around this idea, and it adds a little extra complexity to the platforming. It can certainly become a bit of a safety net. You'll have seen me spinning in plenty of spots where just a double jump would have been enough. However, the move is complicated enough to pull off, XX circle quickly, that players at least have to earn that safety net each time. Next up is Snowy Mountain, where some ice physics make an appearance. There's a lot of hostility towards ice physics among gamers, but I don't think they're necessarily bad as a concept. The argument against them is usually that they change the movement mechanics the player has spent the entire game learning. The way I see it though, if a game is going to have emphasis on gameplay variety like Jak and Daxter does, it only makes sense that the basic movement mechanics should be varied from time to time as well. But I'm only willing to defend the concept because the execution in Jak and Daxter is indeed poor. Most of the ice in the level is placed around these switches, so it seems like it's only here to make them hard to land on. With the regular movement controls, landing on these wouldn't even qualify as a challenge, so the ice only serves to make a simple task difficult and inconvenience the player. The reason I dislike these sections then is because I don't think inconvenience is a good source of challenge. There's an obvious way ice physics could have been used to create an interesting challenge, and again, it's frustrating because the game comes so close to pulling it off. The player could have been required to build up momentum on the ice to make a longer jump than Jak normally could, and then had to cancel all their momentum before they slid off the next ice platform. There's a section of the level that almost does this, but the gaps here are all short enough to jump over from a standstill without any momentum at all. Again, the game comes so close to combining two concepts in an interesting way, but stops just short of actually doing it. There's one last zoomer stage before the final level, and it does a good job of ramping up the difficulty, with tighter gaps and narrower paths. Transitioning from the natural volcano environment to the wrought iron industrial complex sets the tone well for the finale. In the final level, Jak and Daxter have to free three sages, a goal which takes advantage of both linear and open design. The player can do these in any order, but all three paths are linear, allowing the developers to send off a select few gameplay elements by giving the difficulty one last push. In particular, the blue eco leaps get taken to the limit, with moving pads and nothing else to stand on. The path that throws a huge amount of enemies at you perhaps doesn't go over so well, but I've said my piece on the combat. The final boss is very much in keeping with the final bosses in the Crash series. It's not difficult since its attacks are telegraphed so very, very clearly, but the spectacle of fighting a giant robot is, or at least used to be, very visually impressive. It's pretty spectacular to do a massive blue eco leap to avoid one of the boss's attacks with the whole game world falling away below you. It's a little like the engine boss from Crash 3 if that fight had used the base mechanics. And since this fight does use the base mechanics, it is a decent test of skill in line with the game's overall low difficulty. It's just a shame the player doesn't get to use the light eco themselves. It's always a little less satisfying when the final blow is dealt in a cutscene. As I said at the beginning of the video, Nintendo and Rareware had spent the Nintendo 64's entire lifespan refining the collectathon. From the day the N64 launched with Super Mario 64 to the end of the year 2000 with Banjo-Tooie. It's absolutely incredible that Naughty Dog outdid them all on their very first try. From the open world the PS2 allowed, to Jak's moveset, to the throwaway mechanics and minigames, to the level design, almost every element of the game comes together to create a collectathon that isn't about ticking off a checklist, isn't about the collectibles, but is instead about the way that you find them. The golden age of collectathons came to an end around 2002, perhaps because no one thought they could ever do it better than Jak and Daxter. Thank you for watching. Just as a bit of a footnote here, I want to plug some other people's videos on Jak and Daxter for anyone who's interested in learning more about the game. First and foremost, Point Zero has a fantastic video very similar to this one. If you think I forgot to mention something, there's a good chance I was trying to avoid repeating stuff he'd already said. Also, I avoided talking about the animation in Jak and Daxter, which I think is fantastic, because both Dan from Extra Credits and Classic Game Junkie have excellent videos on the subject. They are themselves animators, so I'm happy to leave that subject to them. Lastly, if you didn't go back and watch my Crash Bandicoot videos before watching this one, they can be found here if that sounds like something you'd be interested in.